This small hotel stood for nearly 60 years in the middle of the Thames as a monument to one man's folly. In 1913, Fred Karno spent £70,000 to build a fun palace on Tags Island near Hampton Court. He called it the Karsino, and it was here he met his Waterloo.
Looking through the window, you can see a distant steeple, not a sign of people.
Fifty years ago, Karsino was the inn place for the smart set. Regular visitors included King Manuel of Portugal and the Duchess of Albany. Jack Hilton and his band played for tea dances in the ballroom, and boatloads of theatrical and society swells steamed up from Kingston for the weekend. Fred Karno, this was a dream come true. His was the only houseboat on the Thames with a marble bathroom. Karno had become a trade name for comedy all over the world, and it wasn't even his real name. He was born Fred Westcott, and at 15 he turned from plumbing to gymnastics and joined Ginetti's travelling circus. He did a bit of everything. Barker, acrobat, clown. And he did it everywhere. Under canvas, in open air pantomimes. And in fairground booths. In 1887, he came to London to try and break into music hall. For a while, he was a busker outside West End theatres, but his big chance came when an act called The Three Karnos failed to turn up one night for their spot at the old Metropolitan Music Hall, Edgware Road. Fred and two friends stepped in. They made such a hit, they decided to keep the name, and Fred Karno never looked back. Branching out on his own, he recruited a gang of comedians and drilled them in a blend of acrobatics and pantomime. This was the Karno magic. His sketches topped music hall bills throughout the country. Jack Melville, star of The Hydro, joined the company in 1904. He's 88 this week.
We always looked upon ourselves as Karno's punks, ready to take the nap and fall on their bottoms, and all kinds. In fact, I think the custard pie era started with him 60 years ago, and he's still doing today. Well, do you know, all the time I was with Karno, and now this extraordinary part about him, I was with him for 12 years. I never once called him Fred. Now, old Karno, like a lot of little men, he liked to be rather dignified, and he liked to be called, to be respected. And he was always Mr. Karno to me, and I think he liked me for that. He had a funny little way of saying, he didn't say much, he said, now, won't you do so-and-so? See what I mean? See? It was all see afterwards with him. Because what you saw was all that mattered to him. Well, that's how it was with me with Karno. So I've got nothing to complain about him. He's treated me well, but the biggest money I ever had with him was £7.10 a week. And he wrote a letter to me saying, considering the part you are playing, I think I will make your money £7.10 a week. So you see, I was never much of a star with him.
Karno's most famous sketch, Mumming Birds, starred a young man that Karno thought was too shy to go far, Charlie Chaplin. Chaplin played the drunken swell when the show toured America in 1910. He never came back. And 5 years later, he made this film version, which is the nearest we'll ever see to an original Karno sketch.
They're going to give him the custard pie now. Now look out, here it comes. Never fails. I did it 70 years ago. Here they go, it's a good old custard pie. Here it comes, never misses. And that's a custard pie 50 years ago. Give it in, Charlie. I'm waiting, but it seems you'll never come. That's any good. Yes. That bonk. Never fails, a good old custard pie. Hey, look at old Charlie, look what he's there. Oh, look at him. Look, nice to see him so young looking, isn't it, eh? Well, he was a born genius, and the strange part about it, the first person to call him a genius was my wife. She was in the show, and it used to annoy Weldon very much indeed because of a Sunday morning when Charlie used to come down to train call, very untidy. But carrying his violin case, because he always had his violin with him. He used to start, well, he used to say sarcastically, look at your little genius. Look at him, he hasn't cleaned his shoes this morning. See? I used to, that with him, there's no doubt about it. All he concentrated on was his work. He had no thought about his appearance. But in after years, he became quite a Don Juan, as you know. I'm very proud to say that when we were dressing side by side at the Empire Glasgow, when I played this part to him, I said, how am I doing, Charlie? Jack, my boy, I'm getting quite jealous of you. Of course, that was only a compliment. He knew really how duff I was in comparison to him.
Chaplin's success in the movies prompted another Karno plonk, Stan Jefferson, to follow him to Hollywood, where he became Stan Laurel. But Karno survived without them. He now had 12 companies on the road, and his name on the bill would fill any hall from Accrington to Exeter. Flush with success, King Karno lavished £8,000 on this regal houseboat, the Astoria, where he shared his bed with one or more of his young ladies. The rest of the company were not so favoured. Overworked and underpaid, like most music hall artists in 1912, they went on strike.
And O'Mari Lloyd, who was always a great friend of the underdogs, she stuck with us. And she stood up outside the Empress Bricks and made a speech on our behalf and sang our little song. Karno, Karno, open your eyes and wake. You're keeping your people's salaries down, soon they'll have nothing to take. While you're on your houseboat, your manager will sell you a pup. If you don't want to lose the best boys you've got, Karno, wake up. And then Mari sang, oh, Mr. Karno, what are you trying to do? Make more money from your sketches if what they say is true. But all your boys are winners, not ones and also ran. Oh, Mr. Karno, don't be a silly man. That was Mari Lloyd singing to Karno. Well, eventually Karno gave in and gave us another £5 each, that's all. We thought we were doing very well at £5 in those days. I remember when I was at Hydra, coming along with Alf Reeves towards London one day, I got him and sitting in the train with him. He said, well, Jack, I don't think the reign of your sort of comic's going to last long with old Fred. He said, He's going to have big names now. And that's where he made a mistake. And as far as the houseboat's concerned, I think along there on the river, there were a lot of retired people lived there, and they used to see the thousands of people that used to go for Sunday to Tags Island. There was a pub on Tags Island, as you know, and they used to cross over there, and they said, well, Fred, if all those people come there, you just imagine if you had a proper place there like that in the south of France. What we want is a casino. He said, then you'll find that we will be somewhere to retire in your old age. You'll wonderfully be the thing of the moment. So he listened to them and he speculated and he put all his money into the casino. All the money he'd made on his sketches all went into his casino. Well, what happened? They used to come down from the West End, these waiters and that sort of thing. He didn't know who had got with him. He didn't know anything about catering. He was robbed right and left, of course. And then another thing, the war came. Well, that did it. All the bright lads that would have gone there to casino were in uniform. And they became Fred Karno's army. Well, that was his undoing, I think. Now you can say that the casino ruined him.
Despite the bad omens, including a gypsy curse which he'd inherited from the previous owner of the island, Karno survived in the new role of licensed victualler for 10 years. In 1923, a young music hall comedian called Sandy Powell came to call at Karsino, looking for work, and hoping to follow in the footsteps of Chaplin, Stan Laurel, Fred Emney, Will Hay, and many others. Nearly 50 years later, Sandy Powell comes back for the second time.
One week I was playing at the Victoria Palace in London. I thought, this is it, you know, the West End. And when I arrived, they'd put me first turn, 3 minutes. Well, I went on the stage at the Victoria Palace, that massive theatre, and there were two people in that audience. One was Fred Karno, and the other Mrs. Karno. So I was just playing to two people. Even the exit doors at the back of the theatre were open. I could see the taxis and the traffic going by. And I remember I sang a song. I can remember it all those years. This was 1923. I can remember it was just when the Depression had started, and I was singing a song called Are You Working? I think I can remember the chorus. Are you working? No, were you? Are you working? No, were you? Oh, oh, everywhere you go, when you meet a pal, you say hello, hello. Are you working? No, are you? Three cheers for the red, white, and blue. Tell me the old, old story. Are you working? No, are you? that was good in those days. Well, anyway, I got a message round from Fred Karno. Now, he couldn't have judged if I was any good or not. On there for three, well, I just sang a verse of the chorus. And he sent me a message round, would I come down to the Karsino, Tags Island, and meet him on the following Sunday. Well, I came down here, as I say, that was in 1923, and that was the first time I met Fred Karno. Came into this beautiful place. Well, it was beautiful in those days. I'm afraid it's rather sad now. Everything and nothing here. But anyway, Fred Karno said, would I like to play the lead in the football match? Well, we arrived on the opening night. Fred Karno was a very peculiar man. He was a nice man, but he could be very sarcastic and very, very cruel. And I was very unhappy after the first house. Show didn't go well. I didn't get many laughs. I was sitting in my dressing room, and Fred Karno just opened my dressing room door. He just looked at me, and he said, to think I paid Charlie Chaplin £3.10 a week and walked out. Well, that was just about the end of the world for me, but that was Fred Karno. He could be really vicious and sarcastic, but of course he was a genius at comedy.
Karsino was a gamble. On a sunny Saturday, the governor would take £1,000. If it rained, 10. In the miserably wet summers after the war, it must have seemed to Karno that the gypsy curse was holding good. By 1926, he was bankrupt. The music hall everywhere was failing under the impact of new entertainments. Revue was all the rage. Among the new attractions that filled the theatres was something called the bioscope. George Robey was one of the few musical artists who managed to adapt his style to the new demands. In the late 20s, Chaplin returned to England. Everybody wanted to shake his hand, but the welcoming reception was for a movie star, not a Karno plonk.
I heard afterwards that he sent Charlie a telegram saying, I'll give you £1,000 a week if you'll come back to England. That was after £3.10. Yes, he missed him. He never found any wonderful comedians after that. I never thought he was. He had lots and passed through his hands, but these original comedians, I think, were Karno comedians. As he got on, they sort of became a little bit too, well, not plonks, you know. We were plonks, that would say we all plonked in together. Now, just like the crazy gang in after years, that's what we were, really.
After two attempted comebacks in the 30s, Karno gave up. In 1937, the Music Hall Benevolent Fund bought him a share of an off-licence in Dorset, and Karno spent his last years as a licensed victualler once again. He died unnoticed in 1941. But Fred Karno's army soldiers on, led by that first shy recruit, Charlie Chaplin.
Is that cop after you too?
Yeah, I...
It's all your fault.
Do something.
Yeah.
What?
my God, no.
Monday, they pulled the Karsino down. A small detachment of Fred Karno's army came along to see it happen and drink a toast to the memory of the governor. There's Beryl Reed talking to the new owner of the island, Leon Brunesky. Ethel Revnell. She lived on the island for many years. Billy Russell. He once worked as a scene painter for Karno. And when the party was over, they'd chopped up Fred Karno's stage for souvenirs.
I think I can see him today. I bet his old spirit's lurking around here somewhere. Yeah. I can just look in on and think of that. There's old Fred Karno's army out there. Poor old Fred. I'm sorry for him, really, because, you see, he was so big in his day. He was like a pack Cassius Clay, you know.
You know, this old sort of place has been pulled down, but the guy's going to put entertainment here, which hasn't been here for 10 years, and everyone's sort of forgotten about the place, and they're all very sad
today. They
won't
remember the gags.
It's all very sad
today.
Exactly. I remember them all.
You will, yeah.
Oh, well, I should do them.
You've got them written down. Yes. But, I mean, the audiences won't. I mean, the great thing is...
Well, that's the beauty of it,
that
Roy.
It will come out of the flames now.
Do you think so?
Oh, it will. Your old Max Miller stuff will come out of the flames.
I hope not, because I'm keeping that for myself.
You won't tell a thing.
Into our little shell, and we will thank that small hotel.